All right, well, welcome everybody to this Swedenborg discussion group meeting here in Melbourne, Victoria, where the weather's absolutely awful. Possibly is in a lot of other places where you are too. I don't know. But it's really great that you're joining us for this session tonight, and particularly welcome to David Millar. I think we possibly all know that David is the director of the Australian New Church College for Spiritual Training, and he's in Adelaide. But it's great that via Zoom you can be here with us in Melbourne in that sense. So that's terrific. Now, David's topic tonight is the nature of the self. And interestingly, you might just not be who you think you are. It's probably quite right. So that's a wonderful sort of sounding topic, and certainly, David, we're looking forward to hearing what you're going to say to us, and then later on there can be some discussion and questions as we move through. Okay, so thank you very much, and I hand it over to David now to give the talk.
Thanks, Neville. Welcome, everyone. So I'm hoping that this will be an interactive session. I can tell you what Swedenborg has to say, or my understanding at least of what Swedenborg has to say about the self, but I think we can all do that study. And so what's more interesting for me is the questions that we might carry regarding that. So I think that if we can get more of those questions out in this forum, perhaps, then that could stimulate all of us moving on in our conceptualization of the self. But what I would just say to start, I guess, is that our self-concept is probably one of the most significant aspects that influences our life. It influences everything. Our self-concept influences how we see ourselves, obviously, how we see each other, and also how we see the divine, how we see God or the Lord. And there is a question over the self, and that's who am I? I mean, that's the biggest question, and I think the biggest existential question of all. Who am I? And we often answer that question by way of external elements that are in our life, whether that's family-based or job-based or role-based or whatever it is. We have a way of defining ourselves in that more external realm, but there is also an internal realm. And it requires us to give up what we perceive or hold ourselves to be in an external way in order to discover our true self, as it were. So those are kinds of the questions that I'm going to be looking into over the course of the next, I don't know, we'll see how long it goes. But just by way of kicking off, I just will just start this slide presentation. And we all feel we're significant, but we also all need perspective, right? So that's what old Calvin here is discovering as he looks into the heavens. So what I thought is, I just offer this as a quote. To begin to be what you are, you have to come out of what you are not. And I just throw that out there and just ask if anyone has any responses to that quote. So I've got a series of about three quotes here that I'd just like to have your own thoughts and feedback on. And in particular, questions you might carry around them.
It reminds me, Dave, of the very early experience of a young child discovering themselves as something different from the world around them that they perceive.
Thanks, Dave.
I would say with that quote, it says, to begin to be what you are, you have to come out of what you are not. How would you know? Like, when do you know when you're coming out of what you are not? Like,
yeah.
When does that happen? How would you know?
It's a great question.
I've heard another quote that said, when it gets dark enough, you can see the stars. So nice. Is it when things get to a point of extreme, I don't know, depression or something, you can actually start to see the light? Do you have to be, do you have to go through the fire before you can see who you are?
Hmm.
Or can it go the other way?
Yep. Okay, when so happy to hold those questions, just and we'll keep them open. So that's a great question.
Yeah, thanks for that. Yeah, well, Swedenborg, you know, talks about regeneration. So it's, you know, it starts off with repentance, and you acknowledge what you are is a sinner. So that might be the answer to your question there. You go from recognizing the sinfulness, and you've come out of kind of delusion that you're a good person as and from yourself, I suppose.
Okay, thanks, Wayne.
As you can be heard, yeah, you're right.
Yeah, I would, you know, sense that this is a lifetime experience, really, that it's something you only gradually, and it is, I think, as Wayne says, you know, part of the process of regeneration, that you begin to really see in some detail what you're not, and can then work on that to really grapple, you know, with what you feel from your knowledge and wish, you know, your desires, where you want to then move to. So, you know, it's not a, I guess, a point in time, but it's a whole lifespan.
Thanks, Neville.
Can I add another comment?
Yeah.
Going through school, teenager, we're always told, what do you want to be when you grow up? And I want to be a lot of things. And I tried a lot of different jobs. But what they should have asked us was, who are you? And then you become who you are. But I didn't know that. So I tried many different careers before I found out all along I was what I am now. And I've never been happier. So I think it starts at an early age. They should ask kids, what are you before? What do you want to be? No use telling the kid, you know, they don't want to be a pilot when he's not. You know, he's always been a gardener, which is what I was. And I did train as a pilot for many years. I hated it. Absolutely hated it. It's only after I had to do all these jobs and everything that I found out it's not me. Do not want to be a pilot. I'd rather be a gardener. That's what I became. So I think it starts at an early age. You should be asking kids what they are, what they're best at, rather than brainwashing them into being accountants or doctors or something that they don't want to be. Lawyer just recently last year, I found out that he actually he was missing from work for a couple of weeks, and we found out he committed suicide. He killed himself because he was so depressed from being a lawyer. He never wanted to be a lawyer. He ended up killing himself because he couldn't get out of the expectations that his parents had for him, and nobody knew. To the very last minute when he killed himself, he left a note saying he hates his job, hates his life, he's gone down the wrong path, and he committed suicide. He never wanted to be a lawyer. He wanted to be something like just a simple job, like a painter or something. He got that far down the wrong path that it killed himself.
Yeah, that's
an extreme example, but I guess that's what it can lead to.
Yeah, it's a tragic story that, but points to the depth of the existential question, right? Who am I? And you know, if we're caught in something we really feel trapped in, for want of, you know, many reasons, it sort of just lays emphasis on the need to find a ground in ourselves, I think, that you know, has a solid base in and of itself without the need for an externalization or the adoption of something external or what some others put on us in order to define who we are. Anything else on that one?
Yeah, the quote says to begin to be what you are. Do we ever really know who we are or what we are? Or are we protected maybe from knowing that so that we don't undermine whatever it is that we are supposed to be?
Okay, so just let me move to the next quote. And again, just if you have responses, please offer them to the group.
Is that saying that only through Christ we find out who we really are? That's why I interpret it. That one must shed one's old skin to step into the new self through Christ.
Yeah, so what about the idea of finding your life? So he that findeth his life shall lose it.
So for me, I'm looking at that thinking the second half is quite a key to it. He that loseth his life for my sake shall find it. So that sort of points to a more internal aspect. So if you find your life in spiritual terms, you'll lose your material attachments, and therefore you're losing your material attachments and finding your true inner self. Now, you know, how you do that, I'm still working on it, but that's how it speaks to me.
Yep. So it kind of speaks of two kinds of life here, I think.
Yeah.
Of totally different qualities. I think that helps, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks, Lane.
Because clearly the first phrase, finding his life shall lose it, it's not in relation to finding it for my sake. It's a different, as you say, Dave, a different type of life that's referring to. And then the material life. So if you sort of place everything in relation to your material life, then really you lose it.
Yeah, so I think so. It spoke to me about what we invest our sense of self in has a big bearing on how things pan out for us. And I mean that's clearly a key aspect of the gospel message in terms of whether we move and seek our life in externals or look to develop an internal life. So that those were some of the things that came to me as I was thinking about this particular verse.
I'm wondering too if it's to do with ownership. whether what you own as your life, you see as yours, whereas to give up your life, you see your life as being the Lord's flowing into you.
Nice. So this kind of summarizes a lot of what people have said, but if anyone has any further thoughts on this, that would be great.
Yeah, I was thinking about that quite a lot recently, and it seems that the Lord set up the conditions in ways that we kind of have work to do, because, like, you know, that seems to be the main issue that we have in spiritual work. I don't mean earthly work, but spiritual work is to me like you're given things that come up for you, whatever arises, and that's given to us so that we can work out what we're going to accept. We're going to accept goodness and truth, or evils and falsities, I guess. So, you know, that's the conditions that the Lord set up for us. We're sort of given this challenge. Here it is, have a go now, look at what you're doing, if you're prepared to look at what you're doing and see what's going on, and then see what you need to turn your back on. So, yeah, that's how that speaks to me.
Thanks, Lane. So in another, go ahead.
I was just sort of thinking, David, where it says man is born to evils of every kind, we're born potentially to those evils of every kind. So I always get a little bit concerned that it could indicate to the reader that we are evil when we're born, you know, and that's not the case. You know, we are in balance of good and evil from the spiritual world. But we have that potential to fall into any evil during our life, if that's what we desire.
These are really challenging statements, aren't they?
That doesn't happen until adulthood anyway, that we can really make that decision as to which way we're going to go.
Yeah, totally. And so what's interesting about this, because I was thinking about that myself, Neville, what's interesting about this is if you think about the birth being spoken about here as a spiritual awakening that's starting to occur,
mm-hmm.
then the idea of being born to evils is an awakening to what's been active. So it's talking about a being born into spiritual knowledge, if you like, which of course, as soon as spiritual knowledge becomes apparent or truths become apparent, their opposite also is revealed. And then the process of repentance begins to unfold. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I can see that, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so...
You read the whole of 520 to 524, I think, when I get home.
Yeah, so... Mm. Yep, go ahead.
If you can't see or recognize what evil is, you can't repent of it.
Right. And you can't be held guilty of it either.
For it either.
Mm.
Yeah.
One of the things that just popped into my head reading that is, I actually don't think I've ever seen anything written up where it says, man is born into every good and truth of every kind, kind of thing. I don't think I've ever seen that in Swedenborg.
Yep.
They could flip it the other way.
I don't think it's there, to be honest.
No.
So.
No.
Yep. Yeah.
There have been stories in the past of twins separated at birth and being adopted by two radically different families, and one's gone off to become, you know, an upstanding citizen, and another twin's gone off to become, you know, jailed and a life of crime. So I guess we are victims of circumstance, had the roles been reversed, it would have just happened exactly the same. But you can, you know, I guess, the example of the twins there, you know, both born of the same, you know, mother, but they've gone to adopt families that have gone in radically different directions. So I guess one was born into love and one was born into, you know, evil, I guess.
Well, some of I think the idea here is that wherever there, and we're going to get to this a little bit just a little bit later, but the idea here is that the realization that in and of ourselves, that is apart from an acknowledgement of the divine, we're certainly prone to evils of every kind, but we're likely to fall into them as well. So it's an interesting question. You know, evil is a very loaded term, as is sin. They're not popular, particularly in our current culture. But we need a broader understanding of what's being spoken about throughout Swedenborg's writings when these terms are used, because he's opening up the state of that sense of self that we are identified with as we, prior to coming into a knowledge of spiritual realities. And the evils that arise out of believing ourselves to be independent and autonomous in ourselves, or having life in ourselves. And until we work through and acknowledge that that's not the case, then the Lord cannot flow into that belief, because the belief is a falsity. Primarily, the idea is that there is only one life, and that is the Lord. And until that is acknowledged, we will struggle. We will struggle because we are moving in the belief that we have life in ourselves, and that is a purely divine attribute. It's a definition of divinity, not of a finite being like ourselves. Happy for any comment on what I've just said there. So if you have something to say, please feel free to do that. Okay, so what I'd like to do is I'm just going to just provide you with a bit of an outline of some of the topics that I hope to cover. I don't know if we'll get through all of them, but we'll see how we go. So just let me move to the next slide. Just get rid of myself. So these are some of the points that I just want to sort of cover off. The origin of our sense of self, the development of self-consciousness, the quality of our sense of self, the idea of separation from the Lord, so the concept of sin, reconciliation, which is by means of repentance, the question of salvation, saved from what? And this is a very interesting subject, especially in terms of contrast to perhaps what traditional Christianity views as salvation, and what my understanding of the writings have to say about salvation. And then just a statement that to live, one must first die. So if we talk of eternal life as a life that is born of a resurrection, then you can't have a resurrection without a death. And the concept of I am and I am not. So we will hopefully be able to get through to there. So is anything triggered for anybody with regard to those points that are offered there? Anyone carrying any questions that are live around any of those points?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hello. Oh, yes, we can.
The one that I don't understand is the second last one. To live, we must first die. I don't understand that. The others I more or less understand, but not okay. That one.
Thanks, Alice. Okay, well, let's just talk a little bit about the origin of our sense of self. So what the writings have to say with regard to origins, of course, is that the Lord alone is life and that all else is a receiver of life. And so the Lord as life is described as love itself. So life and love are interchangeable. And so when we look at what the writings have to say about love, one of the key ideas around that is that love is in the desire to give all that it has to another. So when you think about that just as an axiomatic principle or law of love, that love desires to give all that it has to another. And when you think about what the Lord is and that he has the desire to give all that he has or is to another, then there needs to be another to which he can bestow what he is to. So the very nature of love is to bring what is other than itself into being so that it can be fulfilled, so that it can actually exist. So this is a primary principle of life with regard to the Lord, that the Lord is, that he is love, and that for love to find fulfillment, there must be what is other than itself in order that it might bestow what it has to that other. And one of the key things that it bestows on that other is a sense that it is other, that it has life in itself. So the whole basis for the existence of love and for love to have any reality at all is that the other must be able to reciprocate in and of itself. So it has to be able to love back in freedom. And because it requires freedom in order to love, it also requires rationality. So the two things that the Lord places within what is other than himself is a capacity for acting freely from its understanding, whatever that may be. We need a rationality because we cannot love what we don't know. So those qualities of freedom and rationality belong to love and wisdom. And the Lord himself is divine love and wisdom. Love relates to freedom and rationality relates to wisdom. So if the Lord is the one divine being and is the only being in possession of love and wisdom, then for another being to have love and wisdom or anything related to love and wisdom, to have that in itself would mean that it was a divine being. So the Lord cannot bring another divine into being. Therefore, that being that he brings into existence that is other than himself can only be in the appearance of having life in itself. And by that appearance, the Lord has to arrange the conditions whereby it does not feel it to be an appearance, but feels it to be actual. So we can all reflect on the feeling of life in ourselves, and we feel as if that life is our own, that it originates from within us. Is any questions around that?
I was just wondering, with that list, is there I think it sort of fits in with the age of man. Like, the first three will be the teenage years, the middle ones will be sort of middle age, and the last ones will be sort of when you're elderly. Is that a fair assessment?
That's a fair assessment, not one that I was conscious of in putting the list together, but nice insight.
Shakespeare's written something similar to that, you know, man goes through seven stages or something, some sort of poem.
Oh, you're testing me now.
Got it in my wallet, to tell the truth, but it sort of fits in with the list that he's got there.
Okay.
I've got it in my wallet. And I can see the parallels.
It seems to contradict the idea that we all have, that we all humans possess a divine spark of God, Lord. That seems to contradict that.
So all human beings receive their life. So this is my understanding, Alice. So all human beings receive their life from the Lord, who is the one and only life, but that in receiving that life, they receive it as if it was their own life. And perhaps that's the idea of people recognizing, you know, the idea of the divine spark could well be a recognition that all life is ultimately one and from the divine. So what Swedenborg talks about is that the Lord alone has life, and all creatures, including human beings, are receivers of life. And that reception is continuous. It's not something just set in motion and then runs its course. It's actually something that flows into the soul of every human being continuously. Does that help, Alice? Is that does that fit with what you're saying, or help with the contradiction?
You're on mute, Alice. You're still, there we go.
Yeah, no, I found it. I'm not sure that I understand that in that case, because I've always believed that we all have a divine spark, and that's the part of, and that gives us all life. But what you're saying seems different to that.
Okay.
spark sounds like it's electrical. Whilst what David was saying is more like, well, I kind of think of water being poured into a cup, life being like water.
Yeah, a spark of a flame has to do with fire. But it doesn't matter, that's the analogy.
Okay. And that, the divine spark is the divine, Alice, is that?
Yes, from the divine.
It's from the divine, yeah?
Yes.
Okay. So within a Swedenborgian conceptualization of a human being, a human being at the very core has what's termed a soul, and that is above consciousness, and it's where the divine is seated within, and that life animates through influx all beings, and brings to life within us our thoughts and our affections, and ultimately gives us a sense of being an independent, autonomous entity.
But also, we're used to hearing Swedenborg say that our life is our innermost love, and that's what he identifies with being a spiritual fire, isn't it?
Yeah. So love has that correspondence. Yeah.
So we're kind of talking about two different things here, in a way, two different levels or something.
Yeah, so at an inmost level, the Lord is the life of every being, every created being.
And the life is that love, and we've got a strong sense of that being our own. Here we're sort of getting to tin tacks and the question of what is self, that sense that we have that love within ourselves, being the what is ours.
Yep.
And still that's that life is in flowing, but and so that's therefore we see it's not really ours. It's not ours in and from ourselves, but it feels like that, and that's why that's where we get a sense of that eternal fire, as it were, that eternal love. That's how I guess we experience the life. Continuously
so,
there.
So we have what the writings term an as of self. And the way that that's so philosophically, the way that that's described is that there is a principal and instrumental cause. And the principal cause is within the instrumental cause, and the instrumental cause feels the principal cause as its own. So we feel our life as our own. Yeah, so we don't have a direct experience of the divine flowing in moment to moment. And that's what gives us a sense of otherness from the divine. So we can explore that a little bit more with the next slide here. So just let me get that up.
What's Leo holding up?
Leo's got a note there he's trying to show everybody. Let me see if I can. Let's keep it held there, Leo. An analogy is a moving magnetic field, God's love and life, induces an electric current in a stationary wire, us. We have no life of our own apart from God.
Nice. Thanks, Leo.
Thank you.
There you go. So just wanting to come back to the story of Adam and Eve in the garden, in particular the idea of the two trees. So this is, this describes the development of humanity on one level, as overall, but also describes an awakening at an individual or spiritual level, so far as we're concerned as well. So the principles that sit within this story are universal principles, and they can have application on many, many different levels. But essentially, it's the rise of self-consciousness. And as you're aware, within this story, there are two trees within the garden. One, which was the tree of life, and the other, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And Adam and the woman, because at that point she hadn't been named Eve, but Adam and the woman, Adam was told that he was not to partake of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and that if he did, dying he shall die. That's a direct quote there. So what are these two trees? And the trees are found within the human heart, and they really constitute two ways of knowing. And we are faced with this choice continuously. It's not something that is purely historical, but has elements which are played out in our lives every day. We always have this choice between two trees, the tree of life or the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So they represent two distinct realms of knowing, as I said. One is a more intuitive type knowing, which is what we would term belonging to the internal aspect of a human being. And the other form of knowing, which is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, would be an external way of knowing, knowing through the senses. So this is what these two trees constitute. And ultimately for us, the tree of life is divine revelation. It's the word. It's what is offered as an alternative to this tree, which is called the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Now, what Swedenborg points out is that the woman in the story represents our sense of self, the proprium, which the Lord gives us, the sense that we have life in ourselves. And the whole story unfolds looking to describe for us what it is to live from the senses and what it is to live from the Lord or from the word or from what divine revelation teaches. Because these two things can be opposed, particularly when the sensory form of knowledge is not recognized to be an appearance, but to be something real, then it becomes something that is opposed to the divine life, which is represented by the tree of life, this being the only tree, if you like, or the fruit of that tree being what gives a human being a true sense of humanity, in essence. So the idea here is that the desire to live from oneself, and so not to live from the Lord, or to believe in oneself and not to believe in the Lord, this is the pull of the senses. The senses seek to pull us toward external life and to give the impression that that is where real life is located. So the inner life, or the life that's represented by the tree of life, is really the internal mind, which is the dwelling place of God. The tree of the knowledge of good and evil is the external mind, and it's described in a poem that we'll hear at the end as the bitter glass of outer weariness. When we begin to believe that our externals are real, more real than what is internal, then we are drawn out into a wilderness and we are separated from the source, that source being the Lord God. So just get the next slide for us. So what the process describes, the casting out of the couple from the garden, it describes a state of believing that the feeling that one has life in oneself is real, rather than recognizing it as an appearance and as such a gift from the Lord. So the casting out is really our own desire for autonomy and independence. And that desire for autonomy and independence has to correlate with beliefs that support it. And so a belief that looks to put the possession of life in oneself separates us from the source. And it's that separation that brings about the rise of the infernal, or what's termed in Swedenborg as the infernal proprium. That term proprium has to do with our self-sense, what we feel as ourself. And as I just wanted to point out here, it's all tied to this idea of identity and identification. So just by way of this term, I will just need to... So by way of the term of identity, if you go into the Indo-European root of this word, it can be broken down as you see there in that first line, the I, and then dent, and then iti at the end there. So the I is self-reference. Dent, we get the word dental from, but when you go into the root, it has the concept of to masticate or to knead together, as in like kneading dough. And the last part, that suffix, is referring to quality, state, or degree. So what we have here is the idea of pulling together or kneading together what is of an external nature in order to create something we can identify with and that gives us a sense of self. And in the case of what's being described with regard to the garden is that the belief that I have life in myself pushes me towards externals in order to gain possession of things or power over people that gives me my sense of identity. And so this is the process by which the loves of self and the world begin to become dominant within a human being and supplant the loves of love of the Lord and love toward the neighbor. So the external identification is what gives rise to the infernal proprium. And this is a life that is motivated by fear. And what it leads to is the human condition whereby two things are predominant. That is the need to possess and the concept of defensiveness, the need to defend what one possesses or believes one possessive. And the reason that there's this push towards externals and the need to grasp and possess what exists out there is because there is what's being sought is a sense of self that is fixed. The belief is that the sense of self is fixed, and that as I gather whatever it is around me to affirm that, then I am in what I call myself. And it's clearly seen in the fact that we live in a life which is basically continually self-referencing. So we use the concepts of I and I am, and these concepts really, well, I am in particular is the divine name. So we go around saying I am, and you can fill in the blank, believing that we actually are, that we are gods. And the promise to Adam and Eve, if you like, by the serpent, or what the serpent said to them, was that once they eat of that tree, they will be as gods. What that means is that they will be autonomous, independent beings, able to decide what is good and true for themselves in accordance to what feels good and appears to be true in support of what feels good. So, whereas what the Lord offers through the tree of life is a more internal identification, and what he terms, what that's termed is the heavenly proprium. So this is a heavenly feeling of self, and the heavenly feeling of self is motivated by love, love to the Lord and love to the neighbor. And in that sense of self, there is a sense of the self being a vessel or instrument by which good can be done to others, or the means through which good can be done. But there is no holding of that as one's own. So that is a heavenly proprium. So if you think about a heavenly proprium as angelic consciousness doesn't self-reference. It is other-focused. And that is the difference between these two forms of the feeling of oneself. So if we go back to the one of those opening quotes, he who finds his life shall lose it, and he who loses his life for my sake shall find it. So in the context of this here, to find one's own life, or to find life in oneself, is to lose one's life. And there needs to be a point of turning around, or what's termed repentance, to which basically means a change of mind. In the Greek, metanoia means to turn around, or to change one's mind, or to possess a mind which is focused on a more interior way of being, or interior identification, which is captured in the concept of the heavenly proprium, as opposed to external, purely external identification, which is the infernal proprium, or what Swedenborg says is hell, effectively. So hell is to be disconnected from the source. Heaven is to be connected with the source. Any comments?
That state of not being self-referencing certainly sounds nice. it's the basics of heavenly life, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a state of angelic consciousness. It's what it is.
Yeah, I guess our aim is to become like that, but if we do, we can't really exist in this world, because we have to have some degree of selfishness to look after ourselves, and we can't be absolutely only thinking of others in this world as it is now.
Yeah, so it's a state that's reached through a transition. And so far as our life at this level goes, we're continually being brought in front of our more selfish states so that we can be freed from them through acknowledging and recognizing them. And that's all done at the pace that we're able to be moved forward in that process, like it, and it's a lifetime and beyond. You know, regeneration doesn't end with the death of the body, it continues on beyond the death of the body.
But all that lower nature mechanism in our life is something which develops right through our growing years. So by the time we get to adulthood, it's in place and it's automatic. We don't have to think about it. We can then go beyond that and consciously concentrate on the spiritual life, because the natural life is automatic, it's on automatic pilot. You know, we automatically feed ourselves, you know, wash ourselves, rest ourselves. It's on the cellular level, in a sense. It's in our DNA. It's automatic.
Our natural life, Wayne, is that what you mean? Automatic? Yep.
Mm.
Yep. So in terms of so when you say it's on automatic, so the implications are that in relation to spiritual life, are you able to?
Well, you know, once a person gets to adulthood, then it's only then that they've got the opportunity to start regenerating.
Right. Yeah.
And because of what's happened before that, through the growing years, and maybe well into adulthood as well, the natural, naturally self, self-regarding life is well and truly in place. It's developed and it's alive and well, as it were.
Right.
But of course, it, you know, once a person starts regenerating, it has to start taking the subservient role. It's still got to be there. I guess that's the point. It's answering Alice's reservations or question. It's still there, but it's now going to take a subservient role when previously it had taken the dominant role.
So, and that comes through a process of spiritual awakening, right? So there's a need to become more interiorly focused once we reach adult age in order for a more interior life to develop. And so that can then supplant our exterior life.
Yeah.
As the dominant
as
life.
The dominant, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Those selfish aspects of our lives, you know, which we carry, of course, but hopefully through regeneration, we can move away from, but they still remain with us. They're still part of us, aren't they? In a sense, they get moved to the outer part of our consciousness, but they're not actually removed in that sense. They'll always be there, and we could be let back into them. I think Swedenborg talks about that, you know, in the spiritual world, and, just to recognize those states that we held.
Yeah, for sure. And So the life that we acquire, the external life that we acquire and we identify with, is the life that we have to lose, or is the life that we undergo a process of losing, if you like, incrementally. And that is so that that life, or the dominance of the loves that give rise to that life, are pushed to the periphery. But that can't happen, as you say, it can't happen in a moment. It has to be incrementally attended to, so that those things that are more external, that sit at the center of our life, get pushed to the exteriors, and what is of a more heavenly quality gets built up as our interiors, as our new sense of life.
Does this always happen on the individual level? How about the collective? Can a society go through the same process? Like coming out of the Dark Ages, we went into the Renaissance, the reawakening, and then there was sort of the Middle Ages, and then again, the Romanticism era, Victoriana era, great poetry, you know, so forth. So can a society as a collective go through this system? Because I feel like in the society we're living in now, it's an exhausted society. God's been pushed to the other sort of limits. Christmas isn't Christmas anymore, in a way. We don't, you know, they're taking Christ after Christmas. It's more of a materialistic thing. You hardly hear about religion anymore nowadays. Even if you do talk about it, they, you know, think you're a bit of a kook if you mention it out there. But I was just wondering if society as a collective goes through this same self-identification.
Yeah. Yes, that's right. I mean, it's we see these cycles on a grand scale, so far as, well, civilizations are concerned. You know, it's cyclic, and we're definitely, I think, in a cycle at the moment where what has served in the past, so far as religious structures and you know, the conceptualization of God that's been dominant, all of that is breaking down. But with every sort of breaking down, there's always a remnant. The Lord preserves something that can be raised up into a new form that's more perhaps conducive to the you know, the mindset of people going forward. But there needs to be a breakdown of the old before the new can come.
As you said, I think on your summary slides, there has to be a death for there to be a resurrection.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You've got to lose your life to get one.
Yeah. So I just wanted to just briefly touch on the concept of salvation. So within traditional sort of Christianity, it's a personal salvation. And by that, what I mean is that the focus is on saving who we take ourselves to be. Whereas from a new church perspective, what salvation speaks to is being saved from who we think we are, so that we can find who we actually are in the Lord. This is comes through in another story in the Word, which is the story of Cain and Abel, where Cain represents wanting to be saved, but not wanting to undergo change. And this is what's termed faith alone. It's the idea that you can inherit the kingdom of heaven without actually having the structures of heaven formed within you. And that's just not possible. So what the Lord seeks to do is actually to save us from ourselves, or from what's termed the infernal proprium. And the only way that that salvation can take place is by recognizing that the Lord alone has life, and that I am a receiver of life. And when I enter into that knowledge as something lived, not just intellectually intellectually subscribed to, but actually something lived from, that the Lord is the only life, then the structures of the mind can be reformed, and they're reformed in accordance with those key beliefs. And as they're reformed, they're able to receive more of the Lord. And this is why divine revelation is so important, because without it, we cannot know that that life is not our own. The only way we can know that life is not our own is through what divine revelation teaches. Now, divine revelation in the form of text, or the logos in the form of text, it is much bigger than that, but the way that we are brought into contact with it, at least from a Swedenborgian point of view, is by means of text. And that text, when it is taken into the mind, provides vessels by which the divine can be acknowledged and recognized. So, and if we want that acknowledgement and recognition to become something that actually transforms us, so in the words of Paul, be transformed through the renewing of your mind, for that to actually occur, it needs to have those vessels within the mind. So the word and the concepts found within the heavenly doctrines provides the basis for which the divine can be grounded as love and wisdom in our life. And the only way that that grounding can occur is if we're willing to take it and apply it. And this is the concept of repentance. So a human being, no one is born into the world as a human being. We are born into the world with the potential of becoming human. Because a human being, or a, you know, a genuine human being, is one whose will is for good, and whose understanding is filled with the wisdom from that, or the truth from that good. This is what the Lord is seeking to transform us into. And that's what an angel is. An angel has all that exterior stuff of this level of life pushed right to the outer part of their level of consciousness, where it is made quiescent, and has the Lord as their life, and a recognition of that. And divine revelation in the form of text gives us the ability to approach that that work in a way in which it is, can be done in freedom. I mean, that's the beauty of text. Text, the written text, leaves us in total freedom. You know, we are free to pick it up and use it or not. And what that text is the vessels by which the Lord can make himself more fully present in our life. And this is why these works are so important, because they are able to give form to the mind in a way by which heaven can begin to become present for us. And so all that blocks that is what has to be removed. And so the concept of sin essentially means in Greek to miss the mark. And the idea is it has to do with an archer. So an archer who misses the mark sins, if you like. So without the moral loading on it, it's just a term that's applied in archery. For us, to miss the mark really is to claim life as our own, and claim good as our own, and claim that truth is something we've come up with, that we have the power to arrive at in and of ourselves. All of that misses the mark. So it is about really, you know, taking hold of what the word says, and using it as the basis for living our life. And if we're willing to do that, then we can be, our aim if you like, can be incrementally restored. So that, I mean, ultimately the goal is to seek wisdom that love might be more fully expressed in our lives. So that's what we're aiming at. And to miss that is to operate out of oneself, believing ourselves to know what's best for our life, as opposed to going to the word and allowing that to teach us and direct our paths. It's got a so this is a song. It's a poem which of William Butler Yeats, and it's sung by Lorena McKinnitt. It's called The Two Trees. So the lyrics come up on the video. So I just want you to just sit back, relax, and enjoy this. So, kind of where I can leave it. If there's any other questions or comments, then please feel free to bring those.
Oh, Leo's got something. Let's see if we can hold it up for us at the camera there again, and we'll have a look at what you've got to say there. Sorry, you'll have to hold it quite still. It's hard. Thinking of oneself as a vessel is important because it helps us understand the reality of our finiteness and dependence and limitedness. Otherwise, we have no boundary or definition to our self-concept. Thank you.
Great. Thanks, Leo.
Oh, and there's more.
One still.
We are a vessel. We are the necessary external outside form that identity holds God's life inside us. We need to look inside us to find it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any other questions for Dave? No? Well, we might draw a line under the evening there, and that being the case. Did you want to say anything, Neville, in particular?
Well, I certainly would like to thank David for that fascinating talk. Realize how vast the subject is and the depth that there is in considering the whole subject of the self. So, look, thanks very much for bringing that all forward, David, and bringing it all together in that sense. And I rather like that last sentence of the song, Beloved, look within thine own heart. Felt that was a really good final summary of the whole evening. So thank you very much. Thank you so much. And I'm sure everybody, I speak on behalf of everybody in those things.
Thank you, David. Very, very good.
Yeah, nice to meet you all. And thanks for the invite.
I'll just add one more thing, and that's just to let everybody know that our meeting next month is, I think, the 27th of May, I think is the date. And we'll be welcoming Sarah Walker. And Sarah told me today that her topic is decoding Swedenborg.
Oh, wow.
So we'll send out publicity as we normally do within the next couple of weeks, so you can get a sense of what that's going to be about. I notice Leo's got another something that I think that's...
Isn't there Louis?
Louis holding it, I think. Thank you, David, and everyone. God bless. Yes, thank you indeed. It's been lovely to see you all. Yeah, and we look forward to seeing you again next month.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks again, David.
Okay. All right. No worries.
All the best and good night to everyone.
Thank you all. Good night.
Bye-bye. Bye.